off of your shoulders. How can we see from a broad view what's happening in the industry, what's working, and then bring it back to you so you can implement it immediately in your business? So I hope today that's really what we bring. I want to ask you guys, how many of you are frustrated with social media? How many of you, like, your armpits get sweaty when you have to write an Instagram, like, post description, right? It's as painful as writing a product description sometimes, right? And you want to punch Mark Zuckerberg in the face sometimes when there's an outage on Facebook. How many of you guys had the outage? You had to deal with that several times? You know, the comments little team is like, yes, amen. It can be often frustrating. So I want to talk today about some common struggles and how we can overcome them. I've got five things we're going to talk about. But I know you guys are working so hard to build your brand, to do great product photography, to set yourself apart. But the issue is, if nobody sees your content, they can't choose you. I saw this saying a while ago, a brand is a reason for people to choose you. And I thought about it this morning in two ways. A, that's what boutique owners do. This is what sets boutiques apart from big box stores every single day of the week. Right? This is why people choose you. It's your greatest opportunity. But if nobody sees your social media, right, if no one gets your emails or your texts or sees your lives, it's pretty hard to make that business work. So that's what we're going to try to tackle. So we're going to talk about five ways to get social media working for you. The first way is I want to talk about the algorithm for a minute. I'm going to show you what I call the reach train. And I've talked about this before in the hub a little bit. So how many of you guys feel confident you understand the algorithm's purpose? I know, we're laughing. Right? Someone? I should have started with this. Let me ask you this first. How many of you feel very new to social media? Start there. Like, you want basics today. Okay? How many of you feel intermediate, in the middle of social media? Like, you kind of get it, but you want more? How many of you feel like, I really know social media, but I'm still looking for what's next? A couple of you. Okay, good. So, as I'm talking, I want to make this as interactive as I possibly can. I like to talk. I'm from a family of six. I'm the youngest. I have to get my voice heard. So interrupt me and ask questions if you have any questions, okay? I'm not scared to stop and go deeper or more basic, whatever we need to do. So let's talk about the algorithm a little bit. Basically, the algorithm is this in a nutshell. Facebook and Instagram want to know that they're serving all of their users the most relevant content that they're going to interact with. And the purpose is, when people interact and enjoy the content they're served on social media, they're going to spend more time there, and they're going to serve more ads, which means more money for social media, okay? So it's all a money game. This is a business, after all, right? So if they feel like people are not interested in your content, they're going to show them something they think that they are, because they want to keep them engaged. So as a business on social media, our strategy has to be, how can we draw a click? How can we get a click? How can we get someone to stop the scroll for a half a second? Because they aren't just measuring clicks, but they're measuring eyeballs. So as you're doing this with your thumb, the second you stop, and even if you don't click, you just pause and look at something, that's a part of the edge rate algorithm. It's going to measure that. So our goal is, how do we get a click? How do we get them to stop the scroll? But then it's going to start to look at things like, how many people engaged with that content, and how fast do they engage with that content? So with every post you're making on any channel, the strategy has to be, what is my purpose of this content, right? I'm not just going to post this cerulean sweater so that people can see the cerulean sweater. I want them to do something. So I say, look at my beautiful cerulean sweater. Does anyone else quote that movie?
Yes.
Okay. We do a lot on our team. Beth especially quotes that movie a lot. Here's the sweater. Now, if you'd like one, here's how to purchase. Or, do you love cerulean? Tell me down below. Drop a link in the comments. Do you like this or that? What is the question I'm asking? I want them to take action with that content. And the algorithm's going to start to pick that up. So, knowing how the algorithm works and kind of pairing one post off with another, which I'm going to teach you about three different content buckets in just a minute, this is where I came up with this idea of the reach train. So, the reach train is basically, if someone interacts with my content, right, then Facebook knows that they're interested in my content. Now, whatever comes next, they're going to see. And if they continue to interact, they're going to continue to see my content. But if they fall off somewhere, they aren't going to get served. So if I'm doing like a giveaway or a meme or a quote or something that's engaging and drawing lots of clicks, now I want to make sure whatever comes next is something that's like a for sale product so that people have a path. Does this make sense? Right? The more they engage, we've got a sale item, then we've got a personal story, which makes reach go up. We've got a sale item, which maybe it drops a little bit because they aren't interested in the product. Same with the second sale item. Now we're going to spike into a giveaway. And the more we keep leveraging these different buckets of content, the more our reach can organically grow over time. You guys with me so far? I see lots of heads nodding. Okay. So that's the basics of how the reach train works. And so when we're thinking about the types of content we're posting, we really want to keep this in mind. How can we post something that's highly engaging and then offer something that's actually for sale? Think about it this way. Organic content is just like Facebook ads in terms of content buckets. There's always a funnel in everything we do. There's top of funnel, middle funnel, bottom of funnel. Top of funnel, we're just trying to get people who are a cold audience who don't know us yet to simply, again, click or stop and scroll. They don't have to purchase anything. They just have to show that they're interested. And then the middle of funnel, now we're saying, okay, you're interested. Now I want you to actually click or visit my website. I want to take my relationship a step further or purchase something. And then the bottom of funnel is the people that are the hottest leads of all. They're either ready to purchase right now or they've purchased from you in the past and you're asking them to purchase again. So organic, you can understand how that works. And Facebook ads works the same way. So we're doing engagement Facebook ads on the top of the funnel. Then we're doing clicks to website ads or conversion ads in the middle of the funnel. And in the bottom of the funnel, we're going straight for conversion ads. We're retargeting everybody who's been to our site. All right. So how the algorithm works is definitely number one. Before I go on to point number two, one more thing I wanted to mention. When we're posting quotes and things, which I'm going to talk about that in a second, I want you to think about even that call to action that I told you about with the cerulean sweater. The same is true with quotes. We aren't just posting a quote, but we're asking them to take an action on that quote. Like, comment, tell me what you think, give me your thoughts, give me your opinion. Always be asking people to take that next action. All right. So, selling is not serving. We want to make sure we're serving by building a relationship with our customers first. So let's talk about the content recipe, and this is going to go back to the reach train. The content recipe for boutiques comes from three ingredients, three different buckets. The first bucket is branded content. Okay, so branded content is anything that's related to your brand, but not particularly selling something. So it's behind the scenes video, it's you at market saying, hey, I'm on a buying trip, what do you guys think about this or that? It's simply letting them know who you are, what is your brand mission, does this person really fit me? Does this boutique really understand me and get me, and do I want to do business with them? So branded content is taking them behind the scenes. It creates community, right? Facebook groups create community. That's a great place for branded content. Facebook groups, Instagram stories, Facebook stories, those are all perfect places to really, really push branded content. So there's a couple of post ideas, and I'll give these slides to anyone who wants them so you can get some of the ideas that are up here. But videos of any kind, behind the scenes, sneak peeks, fashion tips, photos inside of your store, your windows, your own outfit of the day. How many of you guys as owners, when you come to work and you're not wearing sweatpants and a top knot, that happens too. But when you have an outfit on from your store, how many of you are taking outfit of the day and then sharing it with your customers? Right. Simple way to do it. You're already doing it with all the clothes that are in the store anyway, or they're online, but your simple outfit of the day is just another way to educate them, to build a brand, and to show them how you would style the products in the store. So here are a couple ideas. Gosh, these are old screenshots. This took a long time ago. But personal stories, humor, right? Who would write that? I love that Lori Beth, Kaylee J's boutique, she's just telling a story about the name of her boutique and about her daughter. Outfit of the day photos, family photos, more about your mission, your why, and your purpose. Simple ways to draw engagement. And as a part of the reach train, how many of you guys notice when you post like a family picture or a personal picture on Facebook or Instagram, your reach goes up? Right? So we're leveraging these to get more reach, and now we can show our products after this type of post. Okay, the second ingredient in the recipe is sale content. And this is pretty straightforward. What do you have to sell me? What are the products you carry in the store? What do you mortar, for those of you, how many of you have brick and mortars but don't sell online? Okay, so this is still relevant to you, okay? Even though you're asking people to come to the store and purchase, you still have to show them the product online and then tell them how to purchase it, how to come into the store, what are my hours, can you do layaway, what are the other options that your customers have? So this might be you have a website, it might be you have Comment Sold, it might be you have an app, it might be you do comment below and I'll send you a PayPal, invoice, right? There's a number of ways you can share this content, but the most important thing is to make sure our customers know, right? That we've trained them. How many of you guys have ever switched like how you sell your products and then wondered why your customers didn't catch on? Have you done that? Say like going from a website to comment selling or live sales, right? If you didn't give your customers time to understand how that transition was going to happen, how they could purchase, a lot of people lose customers at that period unless they're really, really adamant about teaching and training their customers how to purchase those products. So this is your ask, right? It's going to sell the product in all social channels have it. Facebook, Instagram, stories, Pinterest, your emails, your text, your app. There's a number of ways to share the actual product and ask them to make the purchase. Could be a single image item with a link. It could be comment purchase, recap posts, and live sales, multi-use opportunities. The thing that is going to sell, I guess these are old screenshots, but the things that are going to sell your product the most are the photos. So specifically speaking to those of you who are new in business, this is your first year, how many of you guys would agree to give this advice to newbies? The most important thing you can do is get your own good branded photos, right? It makes a huge difference because your photos say more about you than anything else does, more than words can. Your customers won't be able to recognize you. I look at Eric Kelly's photos, I know immediately that's Whiskey Darling Boutique because her photos are always very similar. What else do we have here? Pink Pig, Ella J, Rosie Claire, Tori with Pink Lily. Your photos will create your brand time over time. Just be very specific with how you want people to purchase. There's a link. What is this? A gift for a giveaway. Every single item is linked. You click on it, same with your recap post. Every single item is linked. All right, the third content bucket is engaging content. Engaging content's purpose is specifically for the reach training. It is specifically to help us get more clicks, more engagement, so people can see the next post. It doesn't have to be related to our brand. It doesn't have to be related to a product that we're selling. It has to be lifestyle content that we know our customers can engage with, right? How many of you guys, really in the last year of social media, this idea of building relationship, building community, pure authenticity, how many of you have felt like your customers are like your sisters? You guys feel like you have that relationship with your customers? It comes from this type of content of knowing, man, you know, my customer is usually the mom of small children, and so I know she's going to love this link that I shared on, what did I share this week? Lucky Charms. You can buy Lucky Charms now that are only the marshmallows. Does that annoy anybody? Like my five-year-old, that's how she eats Lucky Charms, is she just picks out the marshmallows and eats them. So, I mean, I would never buy the Lucky Charms that are just the marshmallows, although she would want me to. So I'm going to share that content because I know, you know, my community is going to love it. They're going to relate to it. Same with yours. How can you just build that relationship with this type of engaging content? Sometimes people will ask, do I share that more on the group or the page? You guys ever wondered that? So the way I think about it is this. Our page and our Instagram feed are always more professional, like a business card. And our stories, how many of you guys let your hair down on your stories and have fun on your Instagram stories, right? Yeah. So your Facebook group, your Instagram story, those are great places to have these conversations and then keep your feed a little bit more professional. Oh gosh, poor crystals. I just love you. Bingo, where are you from, Kentucky Derby, quotes. It doesn't necessarily have to be about your business, but again, it's just lifestyle content. All right, let me mention this. So there's three ingredients in the content recipe, but there's a fourth. I call this like dessert. This is the dessert, and that's giveaways. So if you don't want to be spending a ton of money on Facebook ads, giveaways are this type of content. And there's really two main types of giveaways. Engagement giveaways and growth or list building. Engagement giveaways are just, hey, comment below for a chance to win a $15 gift card. However you want to frame that, with Facebook's new rules, you can frame that. And then the growth giveaway is to build your email list, to get people to download your app, to get people to watch the live sale. I'm thinking Mindy's live sales are, you know, the customers know there's going to be a giveaway every time. So So they start sharing her live sales immediately. Giveaways are such a great way to build reach, but you just have to train your customers that they're coming. And when you give away that $15 gift card, how many of you guys have had this experience? You give away a $15 gift card, and two things can happen. One, the person doesn't spend it. Or two, they come in and they spend $30, $40, $50. How many have had that happen? Okay, lots of people. Yeah, so there's a great opportunity there to just leave that little piece of, here's what's in it for you, and they're gonna come in and engage with you that much more. All right, so tip number three to maximize social media is to be a style educator. I don't know if you guys have noticed the trends in what big box stores are doing, the ones that are still open, but they're trying to learn from boutiques. Have you guys noticed this? They are trying to take a page out of your book, and that is to be a style educator, because that's something they never were, unless you were Ed and you worked in one store, right? So this is your opportunity to say, hey, I know my customer again. Is she a mom of small children? Is she a woman who has curves and has questions about dressing her body type? Like, what is it for her? How can I educate her even more on how to dress her body, how to have the right fabrics, how to have the right fit, all of these opportunities. So a lot of times when you're creating video content or creating social media content, it's not about selling, it's just about educating. And then the products will sell themselves, but you have to show them. So this kind of goes to the idea of price. You guys maybe, if you've been in boot camp, you've heard me talk about this too. Ideal price is the point at which the perceived pain of letting the money come out of your pocket is minimized by the perceived value that someone thinks they're gonna get out of your product. Does that make sense? It's where the value and the pleasure of that product outweigh the pain and the money I'm gonna pay for it. So if you wanna make more money in your business, you want to get more margin, if you want to charge more, you have to up-level the value, right? How many of you guys carry a lot of fast fashion brands and are wanting to get into better brands, upper brands, a little bit more expensive brands? Yeah. So this is the number one tip I really want you to take home is, how can I educate my customer about that product? So when I had newborn babies and they were puking on my shoulder all day long, like, give me the $20 t-shirt because I'm going to burn it later. And that's okay. I wash it once and it's garbage. But now I want something that's quality that I can mix and match with fast fashion. I want better quality pieces. That's why I would be at the WWIN show, right? You're gonna find those types of pieces here, those types of pieces at Project. I wanna have those products that I can mix and match and I can wear them and wash them a number of times. I don't sort my laundry by color. Does anyone else have like a busy life and kids and they just throw all the crap in together? Yeah, okay, that's me. Like, if you can't wash with them and something else at the same time, it does not work in my house. So that's what I'm looking for. So what is your customer looking for, right? I'm gonna talk about this more in just a minute about knowing your customer, but this is where asking her those questions really comes in. How many of you guys feel like your customer has evolved a ton in the last, say, 2 to 3 years? Like, she's changed, right? So if we aren't constantly asking her questions, then we're gonna get stale. We have to be able to change with our customer and know how to educate her on whatever life is handing her at the moment. This is also where collections, do I have another slide on this? Yes. This is also where collections and recommendations come in. This is where merchandising comes in. So those of you who have brick and mortars, you merchandise to your customers' needs, right? You have window displays around the 4th of July and holiday and all these places people are shopping. Those of you who are online, you have the same opportunity with recap posts that you're putting on social media or with your homepage, right? Homepage collections are one of the greatest missed opportunities by online boutiques right now. So how many of you guys, when you look at your website's homepage, have the back to school shop or game day collection up right now? A couple of you? Yeah? So again, I'll use my life as an example. Busy mom, have small kids. I want to know that when I'm back to school shopping and I'm looking for denim, that this store has it. So I'm going to come to your website homepage and go, oh yes, there's a back to school collection. Oh yes, they do have a game day collection. Oh yes, they do have this thing I'm looking for. So if we aren't constantly updating those collections across all of our marketing channels, we're missing an opportunity to let that customer know, hey, we have exactly what you need. Here's an easy way to get it, right? Here's one click to get to that thing that we need. All right, let's talk about your customer, right? How many online affordable, come on. How many online affordable training boutiques are there today? Everybody wants to be that. Everybody who's brand new to this business says, you know what, I'm opening a new boutique, it's going to be online, and it's affordable, and it's going to be trendy. And you're like, yes, great, okay, now what? Why aren't people buying from that boutique? Because they aren't setting themselves apart, right? They don't have any kind of specialization. So what is your gift? What does your customer need? How are you going to use social media and your video marketing to really set yourself apart in that arena? When is the last time you guys sent a survey to your customers? Has anyone sent a survey in the last 6 months? Yeah, right? In the last year? Okay, I'm not gonna just like put you on the walk machine, but who hasn't sent a survey ever? A couple people? Who hasn't sent one in the last 2 years? A couple people. So every 6 months, there's an opportunity to just touch base with our customer, and they feel so good about it. How many of you guys have sent surveys or surprised when your customer comes back and says, hey, thanks for asking. Now, you made me feel heard. Mary Kay Ash always had this thing. She said, always visualize the other person as having a sign around their neck that says, make me feel important. Make me feel important. So the more we can do that with our customers by asking, hey, what do you think about this? Maybe it's just daily on social media you're asking the question. Because how can we make her feel important? Like she has a voice in what it is that we're creating. When you target everyone, you reach no one. Another thing I think is really easy to do in this realm is making assumptions about our customers. And I'm going to go back to this idea of price for a second. If you're a boutique that wants to up-level your pricing, you want to create better quality brands, right? It's really easy to project, I'll say, your money mindset onto your customers. You guys know what I mean? Like you think, gosh, I'm from a small town. Y'all, I'm from Bowman, North Dakota. It is small. Oh, Beulah, yeah, same place. So it's small. So it is so easy to go, you know what, I just don't think my customers will pay for that, right? I just don't think they'll pay $40 for a t-shirt, right? It's easy. But how we ask them, how we try, that's always a question. I know my customer will spend $300 on a pair of cowboy boots, so why wouldn't you spend a little bit more on a higher quality item, right? So how can we start to have that question and really set ourselves apart with price? Sarah's in here, she's videoing, but she tells this story, and I love this story about her staff and her store, and I'm going to butcher it, so I'm really sorry.
You'll be all right.
She talks about at the holidays, she had a gentleman that often came in and shopped with his wife at the store, and he was, I think, a mechanic or something like that, and he would come in, you know, head to toe grease, but looking for an item for his wife, her girlfriend, and one of her team members one day was going to help this gentleman shop. And I think it was Barefoot Dreams or something like that that you had in the store.
Just Blue Willies, actually. Does anybody remember Blue Willies sweaters?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, yeah, it was the Blue Willies that he was looking for.
Blue Willies. And that was how much was the sweater?
Oh, $300-some.
$300 sweater. And this girl was maybe high school?
Yes.
Okay, so high school girl helping this gentleman covered in grease. And I think he walked by and looked at the sweater, and she said something like, oh, no, you know, that's a $300 sweater. Kind of like, no, you don't want that. Let's keep moving. She just kind of projected what she thought he would pay based on how he looked and walked by that huge sales opportunity, right? So I think he did come back and say, no, I want that sweater, right? And probably bought other things on top.
At which point I am running from the bed. I'm like, yes, of course, let me help you. It's a great training opportunity for my young staff member as well, but yeah.
Yes. So, I mean, how many of you guys feel like you maybe have an opportunity to ask more questions of what your customers need, because we don't always know. And it's a sales opportunity too for your team. You're just talking about team building. I know how many of you guys have sales staff that help either in your brick and mortar or they're helping with social media. Your online social media people are your core salespeople. They have the same goal, right? So how often are you guys, especially now as we're coming into the third quarter, coming into the fourth quarter, busiest time of year, how many of you guys have a sales training program for your team? Maybe like on a weekly basis, we've got meetings and we're going over with our team opportunities. So right now is the prime opportunity for that. Every time new products are coming in, for every week until the end of the year, here's your opportunity, whether it's you or whether it's your team training one another on how do I style that product? How do I sell that product? What's the actual benefit and feature of that product? You had another story about, what was it, like a wrap that you could wear
Several
different ways. And it wasn't selling at all. It was just hanging on the hanger until Sarah took the team and showed them, okay, here's how you wear it. You can wear this in 5 different ways. Look how versatile it is. You're going to save money, so on and so forth. And now the item sold out. So huge opportunity there till the end of the year. All right, so let's talk about this. Tip number 5. How many of you feel totally overwhelmed by the amount of content that you post on a weekly basis? Your hands are not very high. Okay. Overwhelming, right? You can feel like, gosh, I just posted to Facebook. Gosh, I just posted to Instagram. And I just put up a story. And I don't know about you, but I feel like there's only certain days and times of the week that I feel creative. And it's usually the morning, maybe like 2 days a week, 3 days a week. So like that's my zone to create content or write blog posts or whatever it is, do the podcast. But other days, like I'm so busy in the weeds on something else, I don't have time to be creative. So I want to give you a strategy today that I talked about a little bit at the Boutique Summit this year. I'm going to give you some of that content, so maybe this can help alleviate some of the stress that you guys are under. So you've all heard the 7x rule in marketing, right? Where your customer has to see something 7 times before taking action, which that feels daunting in itself. You can. But really, I want you to just flip your mindset for a second and think about this as an opportunity. So if a customer needs to see something 7 times to take action, and you create one piece of content, how much less content do you need to create throughout the week if you know you're going to use that one piece 7 different ways? That make sense? You should kind of feel a weight off your shoulders. Like, man, if she needs to see that 7 times or 7 ways, if I just have one piece of content, I can use it all these different.
Yeah, so if I may, I like that thought, but I worry about being too known, right? We talked earlier about being fresh, and then now, I mean, I get what you're saying, but is it really okay to use the same, at Vegas, good buying for you, like, would you do that 7 times with that same picture, or do you get a bunch of pictures in that one set, and you're saying the same message 7 different ways?
Exactly that. Yes, you got it. Woo! So, same message. I'm in Vegas, but I can share, I can give you 10 pictures of being in Vegas, snap, and share them on all these different channels. So it's not like you're taking that one picture and putting it on Facebook 7 times, but I can put it on Facebook, I can put it on Instagram, I can put it on my Facebook story, my Instagram story, pin it to Pinterest, send it in a text, put it on my app, send it in an email, like, the list goes on. It's one piece of he needs a prize. Someone give him a prize. Yeah, a BoutiqueBoss shirt. You're welcome. So, opportunity to reuse content. So, I'm going to talk about the 6 essential pieces of content in just a second. And these are going to change a little bit based on the size of your business and the number of arrivals you bring in every week. But let me give you this as a little precursor. So, pick the one day you're most creative throughout the week. Everyone have it in their mind? Okay. The one day you're most creative in the week. And that's when we're going to sit down, we're going to time block, and this is where we're creating content. Or this is where we're scheduling content. Or this is where, you know, some of you do photo shoots every day, every couple of days. How can we condense those so that we can get more batch creation rather than trying to drip things in every single day of the week? Right? The more batch creation we can do, the more sanity we can create for ourselves. So for us, our team does it on Mondays. When we have a content creation meeting on Mondays, and we talk about what emails do we need to send this week, what photos do we need, what graphics do we need, what new benefits are we going to be sharing, what new perks, like all these things happen in one little piece of time. So then we can go into use Planoly for Instagram. We schedule natively on Facebook. We use something called Active Campaign for our emails. We go in, use Tailwind for Pinterest, and we batch create everything and schedule it. And then we come in the rest of the week, and now that's your opportunity just to build relationships with your customers or do your live sales with your customers. Now you're so much more free to be interacting every single day versus trying to be creative every single day. So the 6 essential pieces of content. I'm trying to put all the numbers in my notes. I didn't. So I'm going to go off of memory. This is all part of the Content Sanity Masterclass that we do. So live videos. Based on if you're doing live videos or you're doing pre-recorded videos or you have some sort of video content, my recommendation would be 2 to 7 pieces of video for the week. Batch created if you can, or scheduled out live if you can. Number 2 is try on videos. and I can't remember the number. I wanted to say it was maybe like 6 to 8 try on session for fit videos. How many of you guys create those types of things now? So that's a huge opportunity. Again, let's think about the wrap that Sarah was selling in her boutique that nobody knew how to wear, right? If you're going through and you're looking at aging reports every week and you're saying, man, this isn't selling, why isn't this selling? I know that I need to go restyle it and reshoot it and probably do a fit video with it. You know, graphic tee, there's no need to do a fit video. Everyone knows how those fit. But if you have an item that's a little higher price point, or that can be worn a number of different ways, or maybe it's a little bit confusing, or maybe it's too on trend for your customer, maybe you got excited and you went to Magic yesterday and you were like, yes! And your customer was like, no, I am not ready for that yet. But it was kind of like the shorts I had up here that had all the holes in the butt, right? No? Okay. So you might be excited about something. Maybe your customer isn't yet. So how could I do fit videos and the try-on sessions to help her understand how she might wear that item? Number 3, based on how many new products you're bringing in every week, I'm going to just say 30. You're going to have 30 new arrival photos and aged product photos. This number is totally up to you. And the mix of what's new versus what's aged, that's up to you and your aging report. So these are just single images of whatever these products are, either new or restyled and reshot, so that you can post them again. You've got all those in a batch at the beginning of the week. Number 4 is 4 quotes that you can use. Number 5 is 3 personal stories or topics. So sometimes I feel like I can come up with things on the fly to just ask a question about, like, I just watched the last episode of Yellowstone, and I was super, annoyed, moved, I don't know what the word is. Anyone watch Yellowstone? Yeah. So I had to post about that. So there's things that come up on the fly. But if we can think about, again, what stage of life is my customer in right now? And what are 3 questions or 3 topics or 3 stories I can share with her this week that are going to build engagement? And number 6 is, what is my theme or my collection going to be for the week? So out of everything that starts to come in from Vegas, what am I starting to see as themes? Right? Probably more game day right now. We're going to be pushing more back to school. Those of you who have graphic tees are going to be looking at, gosh, Black Friday things, Halloween things, like all that stuff is so close right around the corner. So how can we start to plan? What are those collections going to be really soon? So the point is, you take these 6 essential pieces of content at the beginning of the week, batch create as much as you can, and now you have these pieces that you can share on Facebook, on Instagram, on Pinterest, you've got your emails, you can mix and match all of these pieces from this one batch. So the Content Sanity Masterclass has all of this in it, plus the plug-and-play like worksheets of here's where it goes on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, here's a checklist of what goes on Facebook, on Pinterest, on Instagram, all those different places. All right, so I want to answer some questions about each of these things in a little bit more depth. But a couple of things I want to make sure that you guys took away that I think are most important today. Number 1 is how to make the algorithm work for you. If you guys felt like you learned something about the algorithm, how we can start to stack our posts and create more of a reach train, right? Number 2, how to use the content recipe in the 3 buckets. And the 4th bucket, which is giveaways. Number 3, your role as a style educator. Number 4, how to actually serve your customer and not be another online trendy boutique. And number 5, what is the content sanity method? How can I start to batch create my content to free up more time in my day-to-day life? All right. So do you guys have any questions on anything so far today? Yes. Good question. So she asked, Sarah's got a mic, so if you don't mind running around in a sec. It depends on what type of videos you're creating. Okay. Do you mean like a try-on session? Oh, 30 seconds to a minute. They can be super short. It depends on what you want to put them on. Like, you're going to put them on Insta stories, they can be a little bit longer now, so you have to roll over between stories. Or if you wanted to do something and put your try-on sessions together, like use a little video editor and put your try-on sessions together to make a longer video. Now you can take that longer video and put it on IGTV and put it on YouTube. Does that make sense? So you could start by creating, say, 4 try-on sessions. And then you take your 4 try-on sessions that you've individually posted throughout the week. And now I can use a video editor to put those 4 videos together to make a little longer video that's, say, 5 minutes long. And now I've got something think it's totally up to you. Like, I just knowing so many of you in the audience who do them, like I'm thinking about you, Alison, and Mindy, you just have to go with what is your customer going to react to. If you're, like, say, Mindy is, like, the face of her business. We were just talking about this before I came up here. She's the face. So she's at a point where she needs to start getting someone else to do them to free up her time again because she's busy. So, and Alison, same thing. You've got Haley as a model who's been your face of your company for a long time. So I would say if you can use someone else and you, and see what your customer's going to react to the best as you're trying to grow.
Thank you.
Yeah, but there's no right or wrong answer. Yeah, there's one here and then right down here too.
Okay, I had a question about going back to the initial reach, like when you have a really good engagement post, how long does that reach last? Like if you have a bunch of people commenting, when does that engagement with them kind of fall off? Does that make sense? Like, is there a way to even know that? Or does it stick around for a while? Like,
yeah, that's a good question. I have a thought on that, but I'm wondering if the comments old girls have like actual data on that.
Yeah, I guess it's kind of a very technical question. I was just curious because
that's something we could ask them if there's an actual answer. Here's my experience. I'll just give you this. And I'll use Jesse Jarvis as an example on our team. We've talked about this a lot on Instagram. So there's a lot of Instagram influencers, geeks, whatever, that will post several times a day on Instagram, and they feel like they have to. Her thought, and she's pretty analytical, she maybe posts on Instagram twice a week, as much. But her reach is incredibly high, even with as an influencer posting twice a week. She's big on I want quality over performance, right? So knowing her numbers versus also knowing people who do it every day, I wish I had a technical answer that said this is what it is, but I don't. Yeah. Unless anyone else in the audience has some thoughts on that. Yeah, good thoughts?
I would say just on your question, just like for when we do our Facebook Live, we do 3 a week, but I notice like, let's say like our Wednesday night one, when we finish that hour and a half show, we'll have like 1,800 viewers. Even like a week later, because I'll look back like that following Sunday, we'll be up to like 5,500 viewers. So I would say that it stays at that top of the content for that. I don't know about the Instagram part of that, we also do that, but I know the Facebook does, because that's always, it blows my mind that it's still getting the views for it.
The more consistent you are, I think that's the most important thing.
Yeah, we do it the same time, the same day, always.
And consistency for 2 reasons. One, so your customer knows, same time, same day of the week, you know, she has to know. But I think reach-wise, I think the more consistent you are in that training, the consistent you really. That's the idea anyway. Think of it like a freight train, right? So many people get on Facebook and their reach is at zero, and they're like, you know, what am I going to do? But the second you can start to get those big, heavy deals just to turn a little bit, now the more consistent you are, they can turn faster and faster. But we just have to get them going. Every day, all day. Because it was the best time, best day. It depends on the platform and it depends on your customer. Your insights, so on Facebook, you have your Facebook insights, on Instagram, you have insights, Pinterest, you have insights. So that will tell you based on your customer, when are they most on the platform and when are they most engaged in the platform. Videos, I know these guys will tell you this, Thursday nights at 8 is really a hot time for a video. Sometimes it's noon. We always think 8 a.m., 11 a.m., 8 p.m. are really hot spots, but you should just test it with your customer. Yeah. 1 second, I think Sarah's back. I'll come back to you.
Yeah, I was just going to address the question earlier about engagement and how long you can, you know, kind of count on that to work. And there's not a set answer. We've kind of seen 24-ish hours, but really it's about identifying like that outlier. So if it's a post, it's got a lot of engagement for you and it's something that's different. It could be days or even, you know, a week. It just depends on as people are refreshing that post. The best thing you can do is capitalize on it. If you see something and you hit the jackpot, like comments or conversations, strike up a conversation, continue to add comments there, reply to people, and then repost something that's really important pretty soon within, you know, 4 to 8 hours is kind of a good window to add some additional content that you really want to get traction on.
I want to feed out on what she said for a second. So I don't know if I've necessarily seen this executed a lot in the boutique industry, but I've noticed it's more like, let's say, on the coaching side of the industry. If you have a video and you post it, let's say, 24 hours ago, come in 24 to 48 hours later and look at all the comments on the video, and then come in and like them and add a comment. Right? Wait 24 to 48 hours, unless it's then asking you a customer service question, obviously, then it's immediately. But when you do that, now it's going to start to boost the reach back up on a previous video. Right? So think about that commenting later on. And then you can also do your watch parties and all the other things later on to make your reach up. Back there and then up here.
I just want to add a quick tip on the engagement, especially on Instagram. I look at the view insights components a lot. I don't know if others are looking at that. And it will show you the ranking of every single post, the engagement for every single post. So you can see then which of those posts are outperforming others. You can cater your content based on what you're seeing. But a lot of the engagement metrics are being captured automatically. We have Facebook and Instagram, we'll just go look at that reporting. It's the kind of assignment side to the empirical side. One of the other things that we've done, because we were really struggling with which posts drove viewers, so I just say, or followers. I think you have to play around with that to really find a niche where followers gravitate toward your brand. And once we figured that out, we repost that every single week. Maybe it's different content because there's a bracelet set that we're focused on. It's different bracelets every single week, but we post that, you know, consistently because it drives followers better than anything else we do. But it started with looking at the insights that are available from every platform for every post that you make.
That's a great point. And the other thing that you mentioned, I think, that we have an opportunity going back to this idea of not creating so much content all the time. If you go back a year, those of you who've been doing social media, well, go back a year, go back 2 years, what was your most engaging post? Maybe it was a quote or a meme, and reuse that stuff, right? Reuse it again and again. Don't feel like you have to always reinvent the wheel. I think about this with Facebook ads too. I always like to let things play organic for at least a week to 2 weeks, and then I come in and look at insights and engagement and go, okay, now what do I want to use to run ads to based on how it performed organically?
I was listening to your podcast with the Tiny Closet.
Yes.
And she talks about the IGTV